And I want through this devotion that you may realize with me how important the birth of Jesus Christ is to world history, and that your faith is based on something solid, and that you should be so proud to have this foundation and everything that you have received. Jesus Christ changed world history. Can you turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus Christ changed world history. So what I have been doing as I was developing this message this week, I read a lot of things. In my mind, I had the word history change, impact world history, birth of Jesus Christ. So I read a lot of things. And I came to many websites and I learned something about, and I came to this one website that's called Why Jesus, and at different sections, religion, history, philosophy, sociology, psychology, and all of this, and it was all quotes from famous people and history, statements that were made by Napoleon, some of the fathers of the church. So some quotes came from as early as 50 years after Jesus Christ, 300 years after Jesus Christ, and many, many quotes and everything. So I just pulled out a few of them, and to impact your mind, to impregnate your mind with this truth of how important the birth of Jesus Christ is to this world that you are part of. So I want to read a few of the things. And the first quote that you will see this morning is from Sholem Hash, a Polish-born American Yiddish writer in 1800s, he says this, and I will read it, and you can read it silently with me. Jesus Christ is the outstanding personality of all time. No other teacher, Jewish, Christian, Buddhist, Mohammedan, is still a teacher whose teaching is such a guidepost for the world we live in. Other teachers may have something basic for an Oriental, Arab, Occidental, but every act and word of Jesus has value for all of us. And this statement is true for all generations and going across borders. No other teacher, Jewish, Christian, Buddhist, Mohammedan, have been given to the world a guidepost and a change. Some people are great. Some great politicians, some great war heroes have impacted a nation, a continent, a regional geographical area. But Jesus Christ touched the world. Amen? Hallelujah. Another one, H.G. Wells, a British writer also from the 1800s. He's an historian, and he was asked which person, according to his opinion, left the most permanent impression on history. And his response is that judging a person's greatness by historical standards, by this test, Jesus stands first. So if we would judge the greatness of anybody that has ever lived in this world based on how he has influenced history, he says, by this test, Jesus stands first. I am an historian. I am not a believer. So he's not a believer. He's just an objective historian. But I must confess as an historian that this penniless preacher from Nazareth is irrevocably the very center of history. Jesus Christ is easily the most dominant figure in all history. Christ is the most unique person in history. No man can write a history of the human race without giving first and foremost place to the penniless teacher of Nazareth. This is what people think of him. Kenneth Scott Latourette, former president of American Historic Society, in A History of Christianity says, it is evidence of his importance, of the effect that he has had upon history, that no other life ever lived on this planet has evoked so huge a volume of literature among so many people and languages, and that, far from receding, the flood continues to mount. As the centuries pass by, the evidence is accumulating that measured by its effect on history, Jesus is the most influential life ever lived on this planet. The influence appears to be mounting. No other life lived on this planet has so widely and deeply affected mankind. And if you read in this quote, it is his influence. You see, Jesus is already 2,000 years ago. So influence should be diminishing, should be receding, isn't it? But it is mounting. And if you look at this year, 2014, look at the headlines, what the Muslims are being doing. And India, since the new government, there are more persecution on Christian right now. There are law, anti-conversion laws and everything. When we went to Pakistan this week, we heard a lot of things that is happening there. Look at what ISIS, the horrible pictures that we see constantly on Facebook, on any headlines. You know, people are not stupid or foolish. They see that. Even Muslim people see that. Is there a difference between the message and the life of Jesus Christ and his coming here and the Muslims' way of treating people? This week, when you read in Pakistan, these people that came in a school of young children and killed 100, almost 150, crying, "Allah is great! Allah is great!" Isn't that great? There's nothing great into this. If you want to bring people to love your religion or your philosophy, it's not in going to the school. This is Muslim killing Muslim, exploding themselves, killing innocents all over the world. And if you look at Iraq and all the refugees that you have in many of these neighboring countries that goes into the refugee camps, who are the ones taking care of the refugees? Christians. Why are we doing that? Because we have received a transformations, a worldview from the greatest man that has ever lived, from Jesus Christ, a transformed heart. So is there a difference between what the Muslims sees of the Muslims are doing and what the Christians are doing in this world? And if you are connected with some ministries worldwide and some preachers or some organizations that knows what's going on the ground, you will hear a lot of conversions among the Muslim world is happening right now, and for a good reason. And that's why we read here that the flood is far from receding. It is mounting. The message of Jesus that you have received, it's a message of love. It's a message of life. It's a message of hope. It is him touching the poor, the needy, and saving us. He has not come to condemn. He has not come to cut your throat. He has given us the choice of life, and he is calling us to himself. And we respond to the gospel message. How do we respond? We respond out of his love. This is when you are touched by love that you come to Jesus Christ, not because there's a sword over your throat. Hallelujah. So that's why he is one of the reasons why he is the most influential life that ever lived on this planet. Amen. George Bancroft, great American historian, has written an essay on one solitary life. 19 centuries have come and gone, and today he is still the central figure of the human race. On our calendars, his birth divides history into two eras. One day of every week is set aside in remembrance of him. One or two most important holidays celebrate his birth and resurrection. His cross has become the symbol of victory over sin and death. This one man's life has furnished the theme for more songs, books, poems, paintings than any other person or event in history. Thousands of colleges, hospitals, orphanage, and other institutions have been founded in honor of this one who gave his life for us. All the armies that have ever marched, all the kings that have ever reigned, have not changed the course of history as much as this one solitary life. And this is your Jesus. Amen? We're talking about your Jesus. And when we talk about Christmas, we're talking about God coming as one of us and changing this world. This world has never been the same since Jesus Christ has come here. This is your Jesus. Amen? Hallelujah. And then two short one, Daniel Webster, American politician in the 1700s. All that is best in the civilizations of today is the fruit of Christ's appearance among men. All that is the best things in this society, think of whatever is best that is affecting society positively, it comes from Christianity. It is issued of the teaching of Jesus, of his life, of his the power to transform life. Will Durand, popular modern historian and philosopher, when he was asked what he felt the apex of history was, and he says, the 3 years that Jesus of Nazareth walked the earth. This is the apex of this world. Hallelujah. So I want to go to another dimension now and examine a few aspects of how the person of Jesus impacted the course of history, but looking at politics, economy, other aspects. Maybe you don't realize it this morning, but just think about yourself just a moment and ask yourself why you think the way you do. Why you think the way you do? What is forming your mind to be a moral person, of the choice, the personality, your upbringing, your position in society, your opinions? Where does it come from? Maybe we don't realize it, but we think and we act the way we do because of the birth of Jesus Christ. But we have not yet put it all together. But this is his influence that makes you today have the positive worldview that you have, the honest approach, the heart that you have for your children, you know, the values that you carry with you to work and you bring in your families. And everything that is good within you and the way that you see the world is affected by the birth of Jesus Christ. And maybe you have never thought about it before in this way. Christianity is responsible for the way our society is organized. Think about it this morning. Just go a little bit deeper than we normally would do. Christianity is responsible for the way our society is organized and for the way we currently live. How it affected our laws, our economics, our politics, our arts, our calendar, our holidays, and our moral and cultural priorities. There's an historian that writes about it, G.M. Roberts. We could none of us today be what we are if a handful of Jews nearly 2,000 years ago had not believed that they had known a great teacher, seen him crucified, dead, buried, and then rise again. So this is because these men have seen it that today we think the way we did and that our society is organized in the way that it is. Let's look at some aspect and the next PowerPoint. How Christianity has impacted the value of human life. In the areas of human rights, women, position, children, slavery, gladiators. Remember the gladiators in the Roman Empire? We see the movies of it, but did you know that it was stopped by a monk? The influence of this monks fighting the government and saying it has been stopped in society. Otherwise, today we would still have the gladiators fighting and killing each other publicly. And then the missionaries have brought this world to stop cannibalism. They've been going to these countries where it was being practiced. And because of their life and the value that they have brought of Jesus Christ's teaching, they have changed the world. The coming of Jesus Christ has changed the world. And the areas of compassion and mercy. Two historians, Kennedy and Newcomb, in their book, point to the rise of charity in the name of Jesus Christ over the centuries. The historians record that prior to Jesus, before Jesus came, the ancient world left little trace of any organized charitable effort. It was not part of this world system to have charities, NGOs, and people helping people in different countries before Jesus came. An important aspect of Jesus' ministry was his emphasis on helping the most of the needy people and the lowliest of the people. Yeah, we know that when we read the gospel, we see Jesus. And if you, for example, think about the parable of the Good Samaritan, this is a classic illustration that is still part of our language today. People quote it, people know about it. The parable of the Samaritan is something that the whole world knows about and talk about. This is a transforming, redemptive teaching of Jesus Christ. If there's a huge famine somewhere in the world, who's going there? Who's concerned? When the Typhoon Ian came in the Philippines, who's sending goods and things like that? The churches get together. They are going there. They are moving on. They are gathering funds. They are sending money. They are sending people. When we had the earthquake in China, our Christian organization went there. You see, when they have genocide anywhere, for the Ministry of Reconciliation, we have people working among the Muslims and the Palestinians and the Jewish people in Israel. Anywhere there are conflicts in this world, war or something, you will see people called by God going there and making a difference. There's a Chinese proverb that says, the tears of strangers are only water. And that expresses what the world without Jesus is saying. Problems somewhere else than in our own circles is only water. It's not important. This is the old way of thinking. This is sorts of passivity. But when Jesus Christ came into this world, all of this has changed. And his love and action has become a transforming power. People who believe most strongly in the next world or in the world to come are doing the most to improve the situations of people living in this one. You understand what I'm saying? People who believe in Jesus Christ, there is in heaven, we will meet Jesus. We believe there is a world to come after this world. We live in this world to touch this world, and we live quality life, and we live and we do the most to change this life that we live in, because we are preparing for the one to come. So it's not passive. It's not ignoring. We're not looking at the problems of other people like only water, but we are getting involved, missions, evangelism, NGOs, hospitals, educations, everywhere in history we'll see that. And the areas of education. From the very early of Judaism, where Christianity is derived, there's an emphasis on the written word. God gave Moses the law. The law is a written word. They have learned, and he's been teaching that to Israel. The Israelites were instructed to teach the law to their children. So there's a system of education that started from God into this world. But the development of education, where it really impacted the whole world and went to the masses, as its roots in Protestant Reformation. And this is something that is important. Like this week, Friday, with the French African fellowship that we have on Friday afternoon, I was asking question about how do you celebrate Christmas into your country, in your country? When you were young, how was Christmas into your country? And you know, what they have told me is not different than how I was celebrating Christmas as a young Catholic in my own country, and as you as a Protestant or a Catholic. Christmas Eve, family gathered together. We went to either the Mass or the Christmas Eve meeting. And what happened there? Reenactment of the birth of Jesus Christ. That's right? Yes. So I want to say this. The Catholic Church and the Protestant churches have a very successful impact on us. And transmitting the traditions and to each one, generation after generation, a child of 3 years old knows how to tell the Christmas story. It's deep, but it is simple, because it has been, like when I was young, we would go to the Mass, they would have live animals, and then they would do reenactment of, the Christmas story. And since childhood, we see it, we learn it. It's part of our culture. It's part of our education. We are learning about that. So that is something very good that old traditional churches have passed on to us, and we should be very thankful for that. And there's a message in it for all of us modern parents here in this church. Have one of these in your home every Christmas. Build it in your home. Do it in your home. Whether you have a Christmas tree or not, it doesn't really matter. But have one of the creche or the manger and the stories and the animals and Mary and Joseph. Let your children know that story. Let your children that the birth of Jesus Christ has impacted the world. Tell the story. Read it from the Bible year after year after year. Because you know, in today's generation, we are at fault compared to the generation before. And every generation before, we have just inherited of these traditions. We have learned about it. It was passed on very successfully to us. What about your children who are going to high school today and university? Many of them, they don't know the story. They don't know who Jesus is. They don't know the impact. They don't understand it. It has not been successfully transmitted to them. So you who are Christian, do it in your home. Bring it into your children and successfully pass this tradition to them because it is very, very important. Do you know that in order to promote Bible literacy, Christians have been leaders in education? The education of this world has its foundation in Christians led by the Holy Spirit with the heart of God who wanted to promote biblical literacy. This is how the world is learning to learn languages and everything. Do you realize that most of the language of this world, many of them didn't have a written language? Do you know how they have obtained a written language? Wycliffe, other organization, Faith Comes By Hearing, and many other ministries from the past and modern ministries, they are trying to promote biblical literacy to these peoples, and these people, to in order to understand and have the good news of Jesus Christ, need to have a language. They have only like a dialect or something. So they go and live over there. They learn the language and everything. They make it in a written form and they teach it. Education has been reaching to the farthest place of the earth because of missionaries, because of Christian organizations. And the education of this world is based upon the principle of biblical literacy. For those of you who are Americans, you will be happy to know that, and maybe you already know that. But in America, the first law to require education of the masses was passed by the Puritans. It's called the law. They call the law the Old Deluder Satan Act. Did you know that? Yeah, I just learned it this week. The Old Deluder Satan Act. That's a kind of a strange, at the time of the Puritans. This name was a reference to the devil, who Christians believe gets his foothold into people's life because of their ignorance of Scripture. Isn't that great? The devil messed up the society based on the ignorance of Scriptures. So they came up with a law. We will educate every people, and our citizens will be, and they call this law the Old Deluder Satan Act. Isn't that great? Amen. I was so encouraged to read that. Another statement. All but one of the first 123 college and university and colonial America were Christians' educations. On 123 colleges and university, 122 were Christian at the very foundation of their society. While these universities today, many of them have lost their Christian identities, this we know, it is interesting to read that the founding statement of these schools are, and I'm quoting the one from Harvard University, which is a very interesting founding statement. Let every student be plainly instructed and earnestly pressed to consider well the main end of his life and studies is to know God and Jesus Christ, which is eternal life. That is the founding statement of Harvard University, which is not following their statement anymore. But this is how it got started. And this is interesting that our society is based on these values that came to the promotions of biblical literacy. A document that I was reading this week, and it was a bit too complex to bring on the Sunday morning, but economics, work ethics, politics, and all of this, and you see the influence of Christianity over that. And this is your Jesus that is at the heart of all of this. All of our society, that's why I was asking you the questions in the beginning. Why do you think the way you do? Where does it come from? You don't know it, we don't know it, because we just take it for granted, but it is based on the influence that Jesus Christ had over generations. I just want you this morning to stand here being impacted with the knowledge and the understanding that who you are today, where you're coming from, your why you think what you are doing, and all the source of the positive side of your society, of your morality, of your ethics, of your family life, it comes from the birth of a baby from his mother Mary at the appointed time. And the last scriptures will remind us of the Jesus Christ coming in Galatians chapter 4, when it says that in the fullness of time, God sent his son, who was born of a woman, and he came for two reasons: to redeem and to adopt. To redeem us and to adopt us as his family. And this is the beauty of Christmas. This is what we celebrate. And Jesus Christ is great. Amen? Amen. So your Jesus, your celebration of Christmas, it is worth doing it every year to celebrate with gifts. It's a good thing. We celebrate gifts. We celebrate giving. It's part of the package that God has given to all of us. The unique outcome of Christmas, Jesus has started a new creation. He has come to change that. It's wonderful. Without Jesus, there would be no peace. Another document that I was reading this week, I'm not going to share just quickly. Jesus Christ introduced forgiveness, reconciliation, humility, justice. These were not values in this world. Jesus Christ came and introduce forgiveness, humility, humble living, righteousness, do to others what you would like them to do to you. This is revolutionary concept. And these concepts have become the foundation of modern society through being passed on, being taught through biblical literacy until us today. So the importance of traditions, of church traditions, the importance of the truth of the Word of God is very, very important. And it stresses and it points to the importance that the most influential person who has ever lived in this world is Jesus Christ. And this is the Jesus that you and I worship. And we celebrate Christmas in view of that. So I just wanted to encourage you this morning, this devotion. Think about Jesus, how great he is. Be proud to be a Christian. Live up to his standards. Read the Bible. Live a life that is worthy of his calling, worthy of the gospel, the good news, what he has come to do to redeem and to adopt you. You are children of God, so live as one. Amen? This is the best way to celebrate Christmas. It says, happy birthday, Jesus. Here I am. I give myself as a living sacrifice to you. You have done so much for me.